the gods are dead. Their servants have mastered the atom, plotted the stars, and tamed their feeble marble of earth and water in a span of a few hundred generations. Although burdened by the memory of conquest, the 20th century brought a celebration of technology and culture for the human race, and the emergence of a global union achieved not through war, but peace. For a brief moment, the cradle of mankind shined brighter than any star in the heavens. But 2,000 years since the Roman conquest, and 1,000 years past the age of the Crusaders, humanity regressed into savagery. Old hatreds resurfaced. Fear gripped the great powers of the world, and as their strengths grew, fewer and fewer resources remained on their finite world. The coming century was fraught with terror, as the Earth fought back against its pollutants, unleashing hellish storms and burying their concrete marvels beneath the seas. The deserts burned and the oceans boiled. The air turned to dust, the ground turned to soot and sand, and in time, human society began to collapse. One by one, the great powers of mankind faltered and broke beneath the weight of their industries. Earth had become a hellish waste, and those consumed by war were left to bicker over the ruins in the names of their dead gods. And yet, humankind persevered. Amid the petty squabbles and violent savagery of their kin, the greatest economic brotherhoods and scientific minds of Earth reached out from the blue marble into the spaces beyond, desperate to explore and understand all of creation. When the means to explore could no longer be met through the might of kings and Congress, they turned to corporations to fund their research. When telescopes and satellites weren't nearly enough, these corporations sent expeditions to the faraway worlds of the solar neighborhood. And when simply exploring these planets became far too simple, corporations took the first step in colonizing Earth's dwarvish red sister, Mars. But this alone wasn't enough. Humanity's homeworld grew more inhospitable with every generation, and at the turn of the 22nd century had devolved into a literal hell, unsuitable for any form of sophisticated life. Worse still, the plentiful funds used to support these brave scientific endeavors were running short as the Earth's economy began to shrink. In their desperation, these corporations, aptly named host corporations, through their continued support of human expansion, began to experiment with genetic modification to circumvent the unwieldy costs of terraformation and the mass exodus from Earth to the Moon or Mars. This series of experiments, as well as its further development in the commercial sphere, would be remembered as the Kepler Initiative, a coalition of scientific minds with the backing of several high-profile corporations determined to save mankind. However, their haste would result in a catastrophic meltdown on one of their lunar laboratories, simply known as the Lab 44 breach. Although eventually contained some time after, this led to many other host corporations to pursue safer, more practical approaches to adapting to the hostile environments of both Earth and Mars. Initial failures to introduce self-sustaining colonies on the surface of Mars, too, proved disastrous for these host corporations' reputations. Only a handful would remain to continue the initiative's research, and those previously associated with it would pursue a notably expensive multi-purpose brand of armor known as Garamir. But all of this would change in December of 2104. The host corporation, Atlantic, one of the few remaining pioneers of genetic modification to the end of humankind's survival, unveiled their first self-sustaining genotype on December 15th, 2104. A distinctly animalistic hybrid of feline and reptilian anatomy, designed to not only survive the freezing temperature and crushing dust storms of the Red Planet, but also built to function nominally in an environment with little to no protection from the sun's radiation. the genotype would retain humankind's intelligence and basic motor functions. Critics of genetic modification found Atlantic's Martian genotype as an affront to nature and the human image, and despite certain assurances of the design's practicality, only a fraction of Earth's 12 billion citizens made the immediate transition to life on Mars, and even fewer would consider engineering their offspring. But this would soon change. In the next decade, genetic engineering of the developing fetus would be introduced into the civilian market. For relatively merciful prices, mothers could choose to have their offspring develop into the Martian genotype to give them an edge in adapting to Mars. Despite not yet understanding how to respirate toxic gases into breathable air, forcing Martians and humans alike to wear respirator masks outside their respective habitats, owning the natural resistance to cold temperatures, solar radiation, and high-velocity sand particles truly gave the Martian genotype a valuable advantage. And as the choice became cheaper and cheaper for the average human, the prospect of such an adaptation became more and more attractive to those left on Earth. In only 2 years after Atlantic's unveiling, Mars reached its first billion, and over 200,000 Martian children were born. Over time, the market for genetic engineering, as more and more humans migrated, shrank on Earth, shifting most of its focus to civilians already living on Mars. Among several other reasons, nationalism and racial pride being one, the most predominant economic force affecting this trend was the development and commercial distribution of the Garamir armor, designed to negate the harsh atmosphere of Earth's dying ecosystem. Although not nearly as cheap as getting an injection at the clinic, it quickly rose as the de facto means of everyday survival in the wastes of the Blue Marble. The Garamir project would eventually evolve into a variety of programs, each with their variants and upgrades, and is still in use throughout the solar systems as the standard for civilian self-defense. Garamir's success could not, nonetheless, save Earth from its captors. Nation-states, in light of Atlantic's breakthrough, began wrestling their citizens away from the influence of host corporations altogether, going as far as to shut down off-world transportation and entire markets to keep the peace. Men and women of all creeds and colors were forced to flee Earth under cover of night to escape the hell that had become of their world. Floods, dust storms, never-ending hurricanes, and geopolitical anarchy ravaged the desolate wastes. Although many were able to escape, most were left to fend for themselves. Most of what remains has since been abandoned, and the happy few scattered across Earth's surfaces are the few with access to Garamir's plating. It was among the darkest chapters in humankind's history.
But with the rising success of Atlantic's miracle engineering came the continued survival of humanity and a new world. The means to not only survive, but thrive, enabled a generation of explorers, scientists, and other great minds to populate and conquer the solar system, both literally and in the cultural sense. Host corporations, acting as sponsors for expeditions, settlements, and tech programs, found themselves at the center of a greater and more diverse market than ever before, paving the way for their uncontested dominance over the economic sector. The cataclysmic mismanagement of national government on Earth beget an unwavering distrust of any form of government larger than a municipal administration. And with the occasional intervention of host corporations, many, if not all, hostilities between these townships are usually voiced in the economic sphere and not on the battlefield. These greater opportunities and successes would catapult humanity into an era of interplanetary dominance, spreading far beyond the Red Planet and expanding rapidly with every passing generation. In 2130, the first settlers would land on Europa and go on to establish outposts on the Galilean moons of Jupiter. Only 12 years later, in 2142, extreme terraformation operations on the surface of Venus would enable colonists to set foot on what was originally the most inhospitable terrestrial planet in the entire system, And with this unprecedented golden age came the further development of humanoid genotypes. The Cepharians, engineered to withstand Europa's icy colds and extreme underwater pressures. The Vettin, the first genotype to implement transhuman respiration methods, and many more. Although the means to engineer human fetuses is squarely corporate property and varies widely on which host corporation is offering the treatment, some illegal elements have seen this technology exploited elsewhere, which, for the sake of simplicity, has led to a whole host of issues among the lower classes. Namely, the illegal creation of several impromptu genotypes, of which there are too many to name. Unrestricted by the standards host corporations hold themselves to, these genotypes tend to enjoy greater physical or mental abilities that normal genotypes would never dream of. Nonetheless, they make up only a small fraction of the underground, and the technology used to create one's own genotype is usually kept out of the hands of the lower class individual. But this illegal engineering is a symptom of a much greater issue. And although humanity now enjoys a sophisticated age of technology and culture, their societies are far from perfect. The fall of Earth and the influx of starship technology into the public sector fostered the emergence of piracy and widespread smuggling. Given the sheer vastness of the solar system, it is easy for corporate property to go unprotected in transit, and if a colony is far away enough from a larger, well-defended municipality, then a raider attack is all but assured. Underground gangs, syndicates, and criminal organizations found themselves thriving in the claustrophobic first decades of Martian colonization, and they have since found a way to operate willfully within even the most powerful jurisdictions. In the far future of 2190, with well over 16 billion human lives spread across nearly 10 different worlds, not everything can be assured in this age of small government and corporate hedge money. Hence, these jurisdictions tend to rely on either a local militia or, if the resources can be spared, a mercenary band, either employed by a host corporation or not at all. Despite living in the shadow of Earth's failures, there are those who call for a return to the despotic states of the previous centuries, invoking the nationalist zeal inherent to nearly 5,000 years of societal evolution. And although most can't help but think fondly of their earthen brotherhoods, the example set by the petty quarrels of the 21st century and the feuding warlords of the 22nd was reason enough to abandon what had so nearly destroyed all of humankind. Nevertheless, the dominion of corporatism has often been compared to these despotic realms with their unceasing need to dominate wherever they can. Only time will tell if these economic brotherhoods will devolve into their cruder, more violent predecessors, or continue to coexist in relative peace alongside humanity. But for now, in the pre-FTL era of 2190, where religious warlords ravage the wastes of Earth, and corporate gods deliberate among the wandering bodies of the solar cluster, and the human race finds itself the lesser of its many children, humanity has earned, albeit tenuous, a hard-fought rest. For who knows what mysteries and adventures await beyond Earth and all her colonies, in the vastness of the heavens and all of creation.